Well, hello, ladies. Like Lori said, my name is Lindsay Holen, and I'm the Women's Ministry Director here at Saylorville. I'm just going to give you a really general snapshot of who I am. I have been married to my husband, Jeremy, for 18 years, and we have two daughters. My daughter Ava is 15, and my daughter Lila is 13, and I homeschool them. I'm about ready to start my 12th year of homeschooling, which is hard to believe, but I love it, and it's incredibly hard. But I also love being part-time women's ministry director here at Saylorville, and I've been doing that for just 2.5 years now. I love walking. I love hiking, preferably if it's in the mountains. I love coffee. I love having conversations over coffee. I would have coffee with any of you any day. I'm not a super exciting person, so that's really all I have to my resume. But when Lori asked me to share my testimony, it's always an honor and a privilege to share your story, but it also is never easy for me. And while my story is not unlike a lot of women's stories, and some of you in here are going to be able to relate to my story, it still carries this weight and this heaviness with it. And so I just want to start tonight by telling you about my journey with Christ. I grew up in a genuine Christian home where both of my parents knew and loved and served and followed the Lord. And so it was, I had a pretty ideal childhood. I had my normal childhood, you know, issues that most children have, but nothing that really left any deep scars. My mom was super faithful in making Jesus a part of our conversations on a regular basis. And so when I was pretty young, the Lord laid on my heart and was able to help my young mind understand that I was a sinner. Wowzers. I heard like a thing downstairs, so I'm wondering if it happened down there as well.
I see it still.
Yeah. Recording. Okay. I feel like I need it. Oh, I could put my flashlight on and be like a ghost story. Do I keep going?
Yeah, we can see
it. Is it kind of distracting though? Okay. Well, we won't forget this. The light is still on, so I think it might still be going. Here we go. I'm glad my notes were not hooked up to that. Okay, back to it. So anyway, at a pretty young age, I was able to understand with the Lord's help that I was a sinner and that my sin separated me from Christ and would separate me from him forever. And so my young heart just didn't want that. And so when I was young, I put my childlike faith and trust in Christ. And I can look back on those early years and just see how God had planted this curiosity in myself about him and a curiosity about the word. And are we still good, Tanner? Okay. Okay. We heard kind of a, okay. I can see how he had planted that curiosity in me and from a young age. And I genuinely loved him as much as a child could understand and love God. And I really lived my childhood years wanting to please and obey the Lord. And it wasn't until after high school, or the last part of high school, that my relationship with the Lord was really in jeopardy. And I was faced with some major temptations and started taking my eyes off the Lord. I started untethering myself from his word and from my church family, and I really just wanted to start going my own way. I don't think, there we go. Master, on, there we go. Okay. I don't think the enemy wants me to share. What do you think? Okay. So last part of high school, really wanted to start going my own way and not the Lord's way. And so it was towards the end of my senior year that I caught the eye of the most popular guy in school and the high school jock. And I was so insecure, I was so caught off guard that a guy like that would like me. And basically I was so flattered that I started to shift away from the firm beliefs that I thought that I was so firm in. And having been the good girl in high school, I started to test the waters a bit and started to give into temptation. And so here's where my story starts to take a drastic turn and my journey with the Lord starts to shift. So 2 weeks before I was supposed to move away to college, I found out that I was pregnant. And this was the moment that the lies really started to creep into my life. And I can pinpoint the very moment that these particular lies started to penetrate my mind, and eventually they would become such truth to me. I would not have known the real truth if it had just smacked me square in the face. So this is the moment that my bid for authority and my desire to be the God of my own life started. And that moment started when the doctor said, there's a new procedure out there and it's an induced miscarriage. Now, being a follower of Christ, being pro-life, abortion was never an option for me. But I could hop on board with an induced miscarriage. Did you catch the lie? It's not what you think it is. The first lie wasn't that an induced miscarriage is in fact an abortion. It was that this life that was growing inside of me was not worth considering as important as my own. My life, or what I thought was my life, and my reputation was now being threatened. And so in that moment, this life that God had created, even though it was conceived in sin, was immediately considered a mistake. God doesn't make mistakes, people do. So in that moment, the desire to be the God of my own life outweighed the desire to follow him and obey him. So I made the decision to declare who and what was worthy of life and death, and so I had an abortion. And that started this snowball effect of destruction in my life, more like an avalanche effect. So the moment that I took things into my own hands and listened to lies was the moment that the joy of my salvation was so buried so deep in lies that it was going to take an act of God to unearth this archaeological dig to unearth the purpose that Christ had for my life. I had succumbed to so many lies, but an act of God it was. It was through his word and through the faithfulness of one woman to point me so lovingly to Christ, and God brought me to this place of healing and joy and a passion to point other women to him. Now I know and I believe the truth, but I want to back up and paint you a picture of what my life was like before he set me free from the lies and restored the joy of my salvation. After my abortion, my life went really dark. It was consumed with guilt and shame. I could hardly function. I dropped out of college after that first year because I just couldn't handle the academic load. And I couldn't handle the guilt and the shame that I was experiencing. So I started drinking a lot. I started dabbling with drugs. I started doing anything destructive that I could just to escape and numb what was going on in my mind and in my heart. I was depressed. I was really angry. I was really suicidal. And I was just in this really dark place spiritually. I started questioning everything that I knew about Christ and my relationship with him. And I can see looking back, even those really dark times, how he was holding me close, even though I was trying to keep him at an arm's distance away because I just couldn't face him. And so I would come to realize years later, unfortunately, that his faithfulness does not depend on my faithfulness, and I'm so thankful for that. So life was dark, kept moving on, but it was not going in a great direction. I'm gonna cover a lot of years here really quickly. I ended up getting an OWI and having to move back home with my parents, and soon after that, I entered into this really abusive relationship with a guy, and it left me really wounded and just wounded emotionally and very dry spiritually. I opened up to him about my abortion, and he ended up just hanging it over my head. And I believed his lies that no man would ever want a woman like me. I was damaged goods, so I needed to just stay with him. And I believed that lie. So I stayed in that abusive and incredibly wounding relationship for 4 years. But the Lord was faithful again, and he helped me get out of that relationship. And soon after that, I married a wonderful Christian guy. And I thought that this knight in shining armor was just gonna bring all this joy into my life and everything would be just as it was supposed to be. But our first few years of marriage were really, really difficult. And I was really still very wounded from everything that had happened. I was angry with my husband, even though he wasn't the one that wounded me. And I hid my abortion from him because I had believed that if he knew who I really was, he would have never married a woman like me. I was a defiled, life-taking, dirty woman. And so it was after our first daughter was born, and this weight, this heaviness of keeping the secret from him was literally making me sick. So one night I came clean to him. I had believed that if he knew this about me, he would pack up, take our daughter, and leave me. But the opposite actually happened. And he wrapped his arms around me and he said, "Linz, I don't love you for what you have or haven't done. I love you for who you are." And it was in that moment that it was like the literal arms of Jesus were wrapped around me. And that was a really big moment in my healing process. But even though I had come clean to him with my abortion, there were still a lot of wounds that needed healing. So we had our second daughter, and it had been 13 years since my abortion at this point. I believed I was fine. Have you ever used those words? I'm fine. But God knew my heart, and he knew that there was just... He knew that this fine life that I had wasn't a full life. Can you relate to that? Your life's fine, but it's not full. The joy of my salvation was still very much missing, and it was still, my life was just filled with lies. So I ended up going through a Bible study for women who have had abortions, and it was a turning point in my life and in my walk with the Lord. There was nothing magical about this Bible study, but the woman that led me through it had this incredible hunger for God's word, and that was incredibly contagious to me. And it made me just curious about God's word. Up until then, over those 13 years, I would still read the Bible, but I had these glasses of condemnation on. Everything that I read, I thought was condemning me. But it was throughout this time that the Lord started to open my eyes to who he was. He was showing me more of himself, and I was taking my eyes off of myself and focusing on them, and just stopped focusing so much on who I was and what I had done. And so Satan loves to twist scripture, and he had successfully done that in my life for 13 years. But now things started jumping off the page, and it was just layer by layer that God's word was opening up my eyes to all of the lies that I had believed for 13 years, and he started replacing them with truth. So this is why I'm so passionate in life as well as here in my position at the church, just wanting women to know God through his word. He healed me, he transformed my life through his word, and he is continuing to heal me and transform my life through his word. Healing, as you probably know, is a process. It's not a one and done thing. It takes continual effort and continual time in God's word to protect ourselves from lies and to be so familiar with the truth that we can detect the lies immediately. So I want to spend some time this evening looking at someone else who succumbed to the lies of the enemy, where it all started with Eve. My goal is for all of us here to be able to recognize the schemes of the serpent. We're also going to look at the significance of serpents in Scripture. And I know you probably were hoping to come here to hear about snakes and to talk about snakes, so I apologize, but I don't. We're going to look at a few different passages tonight to get a full picture of the characteristics of the serpent, to identify his schemes, and ultimately see a full picture of Jesus and who took our place on the cross and offer salvation for all who will come to him. So as we talk about Eve in the Garden of Eden, my desire is for you to start to recognize the enemy's schemes in your own life and just the lies that he whispers into your own ears. Every single lie that we face today goes all the way back to the garden. Okay, so if you have your Bibles or have your Bibles on your phone, turn with me to Genesis, and we're gonna just start at the very beginning, but we're gonna do some skimming first. In the first two chapters of Genesis, we have the account of creation, but I wanna point out a few things, and I want you to skim the first chapter with your eyes. So chapter one is a very factual account about creation. And here you can see God is referred to by his name, God. That's Elohim. It's a fact that God is his name, just like it's a fact that my name is Lindsay. But now skim chapter two and we see the same account of creation, but it becomes more personal. He interacts with man and this shows us his covenant relationship with him. And because of that, we see something added to God's name. That's the word Lord. Do you see that in chapter two? Yahweh, this is his position. He is Lord God. This is an important observation, and it's going to come into account in chapter 3, where we'll be spending much of our time. But before we do, let's look at Genesis 2, 16 and 17. And we see here that God laid down one commandment to Adam with a consequence. He said to him, "From any tree of the garden you may eat freely, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. From the day that you eat from it, you will surely die." Okay, so he gives a clear commandment. He gives a clear consequence. It does not leave much wiggle room, does it? Or room for questions. So let's take a closer look at the temptation of Eve and what played into it. I'm going to take a drink real quick. Okay, so let's read Genesis 3, 1 through 6. "Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, 'Indeed, has God said you shall not eat from any tree of the garden?' The woman said to the serpent, 'From the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said you shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die.' The serpent said to the woman, 'You surely will not die. For God knows that in the day that you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you'll be like God, knowing good and evil.' When the woman saw that the tree was good for food and that it was a delight to the eyes and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from the fruit and ate, and she gave it also to her husband with her, and he ate." Okay, so what does this passage tell us about the serpent? Well, first, when Satan came into the garden, he used the body of a serpent, one of God's creatures that he had declared good. The serpent had not yet been cursed, so Eve was not disturbed by the serpent's presence or by his speech, and so we assume that she saw nothing threatening about the serpent or about this encounter with him. Satan knew she would not be threatened, so he knew that this was a safe way to approach her. Okay, listen, Satan is not an originator. He can create nothing new. He does not have that power. He is a clever imitator who disguises his true character. Satan still works today as an impersonator, just like he did in the garden. Satan's target was Eve's mind, and his weapon was deception. I'm going to repeat that. Satan's target was Eve's mind, and his weapon was deception. His target is your mind, and his weapon is still deception. So let's look at his first scheme. How did Satan refer to the Lord God in verse 1? Do you see that? He calls him God. He left off the name Lord. He left off his position. Why is this significant? Well, first, it signifies that Satan does not have a covenant relationship with God. Even though God is more powerful than Satan, Satan doesn't acknowledge him as his Lord. Now, read verse 3. How did Eve refer to the Lord God? She also left off Lord, and it did not take long for her to follow in his ways, the serpent's ways. So why is this significant? It's because Satan is going to take every opportunity to diminish the Lord's position in your life. He knows that if you don't have a high view of God, then he's got you exactly where he wants you. And he can just speak anything into your ears and you'll believe it. This is at the foundation of all of our decisions, a right view of God and his position in our life. So his first scheme was to diminish God's authority and place of honor in Eve's eyes. The foundation of her belief about the Lord just experienced a big old crack. She just diminished the Lord's position in her life. She brought him down lower to a place that could be attained, that she could elevate herself to, or so she thought. Another one of the serpent's tactics was to put God's character into question. And how did he do this? He says, did God actually say? By questioning what God said, he raised doubts in Eve's mind concerning the truthfulness of God's word and the goodness of his heart. Satan twisted God's word and he said, you mean you can't eat from any tree? What did God actually say in chapter 2, verse 16? He said, from any tree you may eat freely, but this one. So what Satan is implying is, if God really loved you, he'd be more generous. He's holding out on you. It's like when you tell a child at the store they can have a treat, but they can't have the king-size candy bar or like the yard-long Nerds rope because it's going to make them sick or it's going to spoil their supper. What do they almost always want? They want what they can't have, even though you just offered them a generous gift. They think you're withholding love from them, even though you know that it's best for them. Don't we often question God's love for us when we think he's withholding something good from us or what we think is best for us? So Satan attacks the character of God so that we will question his motives, and he does this with you and I as well. We believe lies that make us question him and his goodness towards us. And now Eve is beginning to question his goodness towards her. Okay, so Satan has successfully diminished God's place of authority in her eyes, and now he has planted doubts about God's character in her mind. So let's move on to the next temptation. And it has to do with God's word. And that's twisting and denying what he says. So note Eve's answer to the serpent's deceitful question in verse 3. She says, God said, you shall not eat of the tree or touch it. Eve's answer is incorrect and inaccurate. How did she change the command that God had given Adam? If you look back at 2:16, she removes the word freely and added the phrase, do not touch. So the seed that Satan planted by merely asking her a question made her already doubt God's goodness toward her, and now she herself was twisting what he had said, just like the serpent did. So how did Satan deny God's word? Look at what he said in verse 4. He said, you will surely not die. How did this directly contradict what God said in 2:17? God said, you will surely die. Here's the final blow. This is the snake bite, denying God's word. Here's the thing about snake bites. Rarely do they kill instantly. It's usually a slow, painful death. Was it true that Adam and Eve did not physically die instantly? Yes. God knew that the disobedience to his command would lead to a slow, painful spiritual death. Lies are like snake bites that kill slowly and painfully. Whereas God's truth, the truth of his word, is like the antivenom that a doctor will give a patient that enters the body, it finds the venom, it binds those toxins together, it neutralizes them, and then you're healed. Eve had no idea how venomous these venomous lies would impact her life and the life of everyone after her. Eve should have reminded herself of God's word, should have believed it, and then she should have left the serpent. It's when we linger at the place of temptation that we put ourselves in the position to be overcome by Satan's schemes. Satan hates you. He came to steal, kill, and destroy, and he wants nothing more than to keep you lingering at temptation. Being tempted is not a sin. It's just what you do with that temptation. James 1:13 through 15 says, "And remember, when you are being tempted, do not say, 'God is tempting me.' God is never tempted to do wrong, and he never tempts anyone else. Temptation comes from our own desires, which entice us and drag us away. These desires give birth to sinful actions, and when sin is allowed to grow, it gives birth to death." So ultimately, what lie did Satan speak to Eve that became her ultimate desire and enticed her and drug her away? It's in verse 5. "You will be like God." That's a promise that would get anybody's attention. He basically told Eve, if you eat the fruit of this tree, you're going to be like God. You can rule yourself. You can worship yourself. You can live for yourself. You're not under anyone else. You don't need God. And you won't suffer any consequences because you'll be your own God. Do you recognize the incredible depth of that lie? But can you see why she was so tempted? It sounds pretty good, doesn't it? To be your own boss, maker of your own destiny. It's all about you. If Eve was enticed by this concept while she was experiencing perfection, how much more does that sound appealing today when we are experiencing such darkness and the world's crumbling around us? So Eve took the fruit, she ate and gave it to her husband, and he ate. And as a result, who did Adam and Eve actually become like? God or Satan? Which father did they become like? God the perfect, holy father, or Satan the father of lies? Who ended up being their master? Once we diminish God's high position, and once we start to question and doubt God's character, we're prepared to twist and deny God's word and believe Satan's lies, and then it's just a short stop to believing his empty promises and disobeying God's commands, his good commands. Eve became untethered from the word of God, and that was the most dangerous position for her to be in. And when we untether ourselves from the word of God, we are in an equally dangerous place. Her selfish ambition outweighed her fear of the Lord, and she sinned, and we face the same temptations today. Nothing has changed since the garden. Adam and Eve's disobedience resulted in curses, and they were banished from the garden and from the intimate presence of God. In the following verses in chapter 3, we read about curses placed on the serpent and on man and on woman, but this is not the last time serpents are mentioned. Serpents continue to be mentioned all throughout Scripture. And this exact word for serpent used here in chapter 3 is used numerous times in Scripture and in the Old Testament. But why? What does it mean or symbolize? Well, it's not often good. The serpent is often mentioned in the Old Testament in regards to those who were oppressors, like world powers, or held oppressive power over others, like Pharaoh, Egypt, and other gods. And then the Psalms speak of serpents regarding the venomous lies that pump through our veins. I thought that was really interesting. And then in the New Testament, it's used for religious leaders like Pharisees, those elite religious leaders of Israel who are called a brood of vipers by John the Baptist and by Jesus himself. This word in the New Testament suggests, and I quote, venomous desire to reverse what is true for what is false. Isn't that interesting? I'm going to read that again. Venomous desire to reverse what is true for what is false, just like the serpent did in the garden. So you get the idea that it's never a good thing. So I want to look at a somewhat strange passage in Numbers 21, and you don't have to turn there. I can just read it to you. But before I read this passage to you, I'm going to give you a backdrop to the story. This is where the Israelites are at the end of their 40 years in the desert. And because of their disobedience and lack of God, they're here and they're in this place of complaining once again. They're saying again, why have you brought us out here to die? We have no food. We have no water. We loathe the food you've given us. They loathe what God has provided for them. Okay, I'm going to read verses 6 through 9 of Numbers 21. Then the Lord sent fiery serpents among the people, and they bit the people, so that many people of Israel died. So the people came to Moses and said, "We have sinned, because we have spoken against the Lord and you. Intercede with the Lord that he may remove the serpents from us." And Moses interceded for the people. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Make a fiery serpent and set it on a pole, and it shall come about that everyone who is bitten, when he looks at it, he will live." And Moses made a bronze serpent and set it on a pole, and it came about that if a serpent bit any man, when he looked to the bronze serpent, he lived. It's kind of a strange story, right? What does it mean? Well, most commentators are they're not going to spend a whole lot of time. They're just going to tell you, simply, it symbolizes Jesus on the cross, but it's so much more than that. Have you ever wondered why a serpent and why on a pole? Well, Deuteronomy 21, 22 through 23 says, "And if a man has committed a crime punishable by death and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain all night on the tree, but you shall bury him the same day, for a hanged man is cursed by God." There are instances all throughout the Old Testament that end with the enemy being hanged on a pole. It showed that they were cursed by God. And Jesus refers back to this passage in Numbers, in one of the most famous passages in the Bible, John chapter 3. So here he's talking to Nicodemus, a key leader and a Pharisee, who comes to him at night and asks how he can be saved. And Jesus tells him in verses 14 and 15, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, so that whoever believes in him will have eternal life." Then he goes on to say, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in him is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only Son of God." So back to this passage in Numbers, the serpent on the pole. Why a serpent on a pole? It points to two curses. The most vile of creatures that was cursed back in the garden, and the curse of being hanged on a pole, on a tree. The creature that symbolizes deceit, murder, and revolt against authority is what needed to hang on that pole, the worst of the worst. So now fast forward to when Jesus was arrested and brought to trial. Who originally was supposed to be hung on the cross? Do you know? Barabbas. Barabbas was a murderer, a liar, and an insurrectionist that revolted against authority. And his very name, when I looked it up, means "my father's son." Isn't that interesting? According to his characteristics of being a liar and a murderer and a revolter against authority, who was he the son of? Who did he resemble? Satan, the serpent. Who did the Pharisees and the Jews shout to be released at Jesus' trial? Barabbas. Who hung in his place instead? Jesus, the Father's son, who never lied, never sinned, who was loyal and obedient and true to the end. Scripture says, he who knew no sin became sin for us. So he took on himself what was reserved for the worst of the worst, the cursed serpent on a cursed tree. And at the moment that he hung on the cross, he took Eve's curse and Adam's curse. He took my curse, my worst of the worst, and he took your curse, your worst of the worst. Colossians 3:13 says, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree. Paul was quoting Deuteronomy. He was condemned in our place as our substitute. So way back in the garden, immediately after the fall, and God places a curse on the serpent and on man and woman, he immediately offers hope. He didn't let them leave the garden without giving them hope and giving them a glimpse into this rescue mission that he would send his son, Jesus Christ, to accomplish. Let me read it. Let me go back there really quick. Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between you and the woman and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise you on the head and you shall bruise him on the heel. This is a message of hope. That passage points to Christ and is the first gospel message in Scripture, right there, right away in Genesis 3. That is the move of a generous God, a God whose position cannot be diminished. Don't believe that lie. He's not a God that is holding out on you. Don't believe that lie. He is not a God whose word will ever change or can be altered to fit your own agenda or justify your own sin and disobedience. So don't believe that lie. All the way back in the garden, God had a plan to hang his son on a tree as a curse so that we could look on him and be saved and to be set free from the curse forever. This was his plan for that snake bite in the garden, the plan that would administer the anti-venom that would provide full and complete healing and save lives. That is the full and complete healing that I have experienced. But I have to fill my mind and my heart with truth continually, every day. He offers this to you too, so that whosoever looks on him, believes on him, trusts in him, will no longer be slaves to the curse, will no longer have the venom of the serpent enemy running through their veins, but will be free forever. So ladies, who do you belong to? Who are you listening to? Who are you believing? What lies can you identify in your life that started all the way back in the garden? Remember that Satan tries nothing new. You identify his schemes, you can fight them, and you can run to the one who has mercy, grace, healing, and freedom for you. Let me pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for being the generous God who never withholds good from us. Lord, give us eyes to see the good, even in your commands that the enemy would have us believe are oppressive, but your commands bring freedom. Lord, give us eyes to recognize the enemy's schemes, to identify his lies, and Lord, help us to be tethered every day to your word, to the truth, that replaces lies with the truth. Help us to be women who can speak truth to others. Lord, I just thank you for giving us hope right away in Genesis 3. And that offer of salvation, that hope has never gone away, Lord. You offer it freely to all who will come to you, Lord. So I pray if there is any women here that are still following the father of lies and are still believing him and serving him, Lord, would you rescue them? Would you administer the antivenom with the truth of your word and cleanse them and heal them, Lord? I just thank you for your son who took our curse so that we could have his perfect righteousness in your eyes, Lord. When you look at us, you don't see the worst of the worst. You see the best of the best, and that's your son. It's in Jesus' name I pray, amen.